We want to invite our first keynote panel up, the Honorable Judge Waxse, Scott Giordano, Mike Klein from Altria, and Ronni Solomon from King & Spalding. Would you all please come up?
Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to inFusion 2014. For how many of you, this is your first inFusion? Oh my Lord, wow, that's very impressive. We have 2 days of incredibly great panels and just incredible speakers. You're gonna really, really enjoy it. I'm Scott Giordano, I'm Corporate Technology Counsel with the firm, and a great part of my job is introducing and moderating insanely great panels. So without further ado, I have here with me the Honorable David Waxse, U.S. Magistrate Judge, District of Kansas. Judge Waxse has been serving as a Magistrate Judge since 1999, and prior to his appointment was a partner at Shook, Hardy & Bacon, a firm that has produced a long list of e-discovery experts. Welcome, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Mike Klein, Assistant General Counsel at Altria Group. Mike's been with Altria since 2005 and is responsible for the collection, processing, and production of ESI. Prior to joining Altria, Mike was a partner at the Washington, D.C. office of Patton Boggs. Mike, welcome.
Thank you.
And Ronni Solomon is a partner with King & Spalding. She's been a litigator for more than 18 years and is head of King & Spalding's e-discovery practice. She serves as National e-discovery counsel for large corporations, providing guidance on e-discovery issues, including both litigation preparedness and discovery strategy. Ronni, thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure.
I really want to emphasize here that the inFusion is for you, and so I ask that during the course of our discussion here, please ask questions. We really want to make this a very interactive session here. So, first up, we're going to talk about changes overview, and then we'll talk about 37E, 26B1, and then finally we'll offer some best practices. Okay. Your Honor, I'd like to start with you. Would you give us an overview of the changes and what's taken place to this date?
Okay, well, this really started in 2010 with the conference at Duke Law School that was convened by the federal courts. And it involved lawyers, judges, professors, general counsel, the broad spectrum of people involved in litigation. And the purpose of the conference was to answer two questions. One, is litigation too costly and too time-consuming? And two, what do we do about it? Didn't take long to answer the first question because everyone there agreed yes on both points. It takes too long and costs too much. The question of what to do about it, though, got a lot more complicated, and there were several consensus conclusions out of that conference. One was that there had to be more judicial case management. The judges were too uninvolved in the process to help keep it moving. The other that I think was really important was the idea that there has to be more cooperation among counsel if we're going to reach the goals of Rule 1 of the Federal Rules of Procedure, which are what they say currently are that the court shall administer the rules to secure the just, speedy, and inexpensive determination of every action. We had a lot of discussion at Duke about how to do that, and the conclusion was cooperation was the best approach. So there were several suggestions from the Duke Conference on changes to Rule 1, and one of the proposed changes that are being considered is to add to Rule 1 the obligation that courts and parties strive to reach just, speedy, and inexpensive. And then the comments make clear that cooperation is the most successful way of getting to that goal. And I, as you can see from the slide, this is an interesting coincidence, but today is when the Judicial Conference is considering those amendments. And as you can see, the process has been going on for years now. The initial conclusion out of Duke was that there really weren't a lot of rule changes needed. We needed more effort in cooperation, more effort in judicial case management, and some minor considerations about rule changes. One of the big discussion points that didn't make it to the rule change process was that many of the general counsel said that their biggest problem they thought was no real guidance on what should be preserved and how long it should be preserved, and that there were two cost factors working there. One, just the cost of storage, but more importantly, if you've preserved all this stuff and then you ultimately have to search it, that's when your costs really go up. So they wanted ways to try and get at that preservation problem. The conclusion was, based on the structure of the federal court system, that we really couldn't have a change in the rules of civil procedure that would have any real impact on preservation, because generally preservation occurs before litigation starts, and the Rules Enabling Act says that these rules are to deal with litigation. There were some discussions about trying to create a provision in the civil rules that would allow people to come into court before litigation has started to get a ruling on preservation. And it didn't finally get adopted, but the idea was, like there is right now under Rule 27, you can go ahead into court before litigation has started and get an order to depose somebody. And the idea was, well, we should be able to get an order to determine preservation, but that didn't happen either. So what the ultimate conclusion on preservation as a solution was to modify the sanctions side, because that's what people are really afraid of, is why they over-preserve, because they're afraid of sanctions. So we've been through all these steps, and today the Judicial Conference is meeting in D.C., and on their consent calendar is the rule changes that we're going to talk about, and it's pretty well accepted. They're not going to do anything other than accept them. It will then go to the Supreme Court. There's been no indication the Supreme Court's going to do anything to them. And then it goes to Congress, and it takes an actual action out of Congress to have any impact, because if Congress does nothing, which they seem to know how to do, the rules will go into effect in December of 2015. So that's too long an overview.
Well, you know, one thing I'd add to that, though, in terms of when it goes to Congress, prior to the testimony, which started last summer before the Federal Rules Advisory Committee, a series of three different public hearings for folks to make their views known on these proposed changes, the Senate subcommittee convened and put a couple of folks up who were very adamantly against these changes. Professor Arthur Miller was one of them. They had somebody who was the head of a big nonprofit in the D.C. area, and then they had a pro-change speaker who was out of Washington, D.C., a big law firm there. So, you know, I think while, you know, kind of probably all of our guts tell us that Congress can't, you know, get energized to do anything for any reason these days, they really sent a pretty strong signal the day before the first public hearing on the in front of the advisory committee, that there's a constituency within the Senate that is listening to their constituents, probably the trial lawyers, and they're not in favor of these changes at all. So we'll see once it gets to Congress if they can, you know, muster the energy and or the consensus to do something about it.
Of course, the other piece of that is that one of their primary focuses in terms of opposition was that originally these proposed changes included changes in the presumptive limits on discovery. And the plaintiffs' bar was very upset, because they were, all the numbers were being reduced, that it was going to impact their ability to do discovery. And that got taken out at the Rules Committee level. So that was one of their hot topics that's no longer in it.
Your Honor, I want to ask just as a threshold question before we dig into the guts of the changes. And everyone has a handout with all of the changes to the major rules. This process started about 4 years ago, a little bit more than that. So since that time, technology has changed remarkably. I mean, we are constantly innovating. Our clients are constantly innovating. Isn't it the case, I think, that potentially by the time this process is all done, these rules may be, changes may be for nothing, because we've our clients, and certainly we have made inroads around them, around this problem?
Well, that's always been my hope, that technology will provide solutions as well as being the problem. And one of the ways they've already provided some solution is when I first got involved in these discussions in the early 2000s, the storage costs were a huge problem. And storage costs, as you know, have dropped dramatically, so that's no longer really the problem. The problem, as I mentioned earlier, is if you store all that stuff, even at a low cost, you've still got to process it somehow. And if you try and process it the way some people still process it, using human eyes to look at every document, that is an unbelievable cost. But what technology and research about the technology is telling us, it really is ineffective both in terms of accuracy and too costly to do it with humans. And yet we still have lawyers saying, I'm not letting anything out of here until a human eyes looked at it. And if you look at the research, human eyes are terrible at finding or discriminating against various documents. There's just no question about it. And yet we still have lawyers. I mean, I get case management conferences going and they'll be adamant. No, we're not going to send anything to the other side unless somebody's looked at it. And when I point out the research that says somebody looking at it is terribly ineffective, that it's like it's a cultural thing, not a scientific thing, so they still want to look at it. But you move to the next step that is probably used predominantly right now, which is just keyword searching. That's terribly ineffective, and yet lawyers are still doing it. The technology that may get us out of these high costs is some kind of computer-assisted review, which is obviously improving almost on a daily basis, and the costs are coming down. So you may be right that the technology-assisted review side will solve this problem, because if it's not going to be a huge problem if it doesn't cost anything to store it and it doesn't cost as much to search it.
Ronni, I think now it's a good time to go into the rules themselves. Can we go into 37E and talk a little bit about that?
What led to this change in 37E is, right now, if you have a case and you're worried about getting spoliation sanctions against you, it really depends on where you are in the country. If you're in the Second Circuit and you, your client, if you're a defense lawyer like me, and your client acted negligently and with preservation steps, then you could be facing some severe sanctions. If you're in the Fifth Circuit, as an example, it requires bad faith or willful conduct to get severe sanctions. So what you have here is, just depending on where you are in the country, depends on what kind of severe sanction or sanction for e-discovery preservation problems you will get. So kind of to combat that it just depends on where you are in the country, this rule 37E, the changes to it are designed to make it clear that negligence is not enough to get severe sanctions. That it has to be, and if you, I think the rule, I don't know if the rules.
Yeah, it's been handed out to everyone.
Okay.
So they all have a copy.
If you can see it, but there has to be an intent to deprive another of evidence in order for you to get anything like an adverse inference instruction or default judgment or dismissal of a case. That's the major impact of this rule and what it was designed to do. There's also in it that there has to be prejudice for a court to even order curative measures. Like, let's say you have backup tapes that have to be restored. In order for a court to order the backup tapes to be restored to find evidence, as an example, there would have to be a showing of prejudice before a court could do that. So this is all designed to prevent that uncertainty in the law. I mean, everybody really on the defense side really wanted there to be a preservation rule, like a, you know, that says at the beginning of the case, if you don't send a litigation hold notice, these are the sanctions. But because of what Judge Waxse went through, that's not going to happen because of the Rules Enabling Act. Everyone's focused now on the penalties, the sanctions, and really it's designed to avoid negligence, that there has to be some willful conduct.
Ronni, I think it was last year, Judge Scheinlin wrote an opinion, and she was very much opposed to what was then 37E. It's changed a couple times since then. You want to talk a little bit about that and how things are probably going to go now that the rule is almost certainly going to be implemented as we're all reading it here right now?
Sure. So Judge Shinlin was a precursor to the change that you see in your materials right now. She's really upset about the changes because she felt it would lead to sloppy practices, that because a corporation knew that negligence wouldn't lead to severe sanctions, they won't go ahead and take any reasonable steps or do what they need to do to preserve evidence for the other side's use. So that was her complaint, that if you don't punish people even for negligence, then it's going to lead to sloppy practices. And so she criticized the rule in this opinion. And really what's interesting about this opinion is it's a plaintiff who she actually awarded an adverse inference instruction against the plaintiff for the deletion of email. And in the opinion, if you're reading it as a defense lawyer, you'll see that the plaintiffs spent a lot of time trying to remedy their preservation lapse. They went and found email from other employees that had this person, had the person whose email was deleted as a to or a from or a CC. They went and found the email, and they took all these steps to remedy their lapse. So if you look, I think what your question was is what would happen today is there didn't seem to be any prejudice to the defendant for the plaintiff's preservation lapses because they went ahead and fixed it. And Judge Moss, Magistrate Judge Moss, who had the opinion first that Judge Shinlin overturned, he had actually mentioned that there doesn't seem to be any prejudice here. So I think this opinion would have had a different result once the rules were in place.
Thank you. Judge Waxse, we are in our daily lives just saturated with social media. It seems like it's everywhere. How does the changes here interact with social media?
Well, the generic answer is it's going to impact your chances of sanctions if you don't preserve social media. Now, the question is, when do you have to preserve social media? And I think my experience with dealing with counsel now in cases with some social media involved in it is there's really not enough emphasis at all on these non-traditional sources of ESI. Whether you're talking about social media or instant messaging or texting or any of the other than just having a server with a lot of ESI on it, there really has to be more emphasis on finding out where employees have their ESI. And that's on the corporate side. On the plaintiff side, you have the same problem. Plaintiffs, you know, we used to talk about asymmetrical cases. I've now seen cases with individual plaintiffs having more ESI than a corporate defendant because they've got Facebook that they're accessing four or five times a day, and so the data just builds up. Because as I'm sure you're aware, Facebook saves everything. It doesn't go away, even though you may remove it from your site. It's there for people to get. So what Ogden talks about is where are the lines in terms of both preservation and what has to be produced, and they put some limits on it. This was a sexual harassment case where the initial request of the plaintiff was absolutely everything they had on social media because it might have some impact on their claim for damages. And the judge limited it to what the court felt was much more relevant and discoverable information than that broad request. And it's kind of interesting because one of the things that obviously is not the focus of this conference, but one of the hot topics right now is what law enforcement can get from not only social media, but from all third-party sources of ESI. And the current standard is in the process of changing because many courts were saying there's no limit on what law enforcement can get, just like this party was asking in Ogden. They wanted everything. And what's happened with law enforcement is there are many courts saying, well, it's too hard to have somebody search the ESI. We'll just let them have everything, and then they can look at it and decide what's relevant to their investigation. And what's left out of that whole thought is the Fourth Amendment was set up to protect privacy, and you don't have any privacy if you're saying the government can look at absolutely everything you have. So there are some of us that have been writing opinions saying, no, that's too far, but We don't have a clear answer on that one yet. Well, it technically, I don't know what end of your domain, because every Facebook or any of those social media sites will give you a copy of what's there at a specific time period. So the way the preservation works is you tell the social media provider, I want a copy of my file, and then you preserve it. You don't have the ability to do anything, obviously, to the social media provider, other than maybe subpoena it if you're at that point in litigation. But there are ways of preserving, even if it's in the hand of a third party.
The test is possession, custody, and control. So if you have possession, custody, and control of a cloud site, of content within a cloud site, then you have a responsibility to send a preservation notice to that third party, if that was your question. The Sedona conference has a paper that's going to come out on possession, custody, and control, and it talks about how there are the different standards across the country. Again, it's similar to what I was saying about the sanctions. Depending on where you are in the country, depends on whether you have possession, custody, and control of cloud content. Some jurisdictions are pretty liberal, and if you have the practical ability to require the person to give you the documents, then you have possession, custody, and control. Other states have much more strict standards. And that paper that's going to come out on possession, custody, and control advocates of having a much stricter standard. So it's much more clear as to what everybody's responsibility is. But right now, I mean, anybody could make an argument that they have possession, custody, and control of cloud content. It's a very, very liberal standard.
You know, and one of the things I think people don't remember is that preservation can have, you may have a need for preservation to present your own side of the case. I mean, there may be information on your Facebook page that you need to present your claim. And so this idea that you're just trying to get preserve stuff for the other side is not true. You need to preserve it for your use as well as their use. So I think people have to be more cognizant of the fact that you should look at what you need to prove your case.
Hi, David Rohde. Are you seeing, and Judge, are you seeing a dividing line between those sites that are run by a company, the corporate presence on Facebook, Twitter, the social media, and then bleeding over into what the marketing department is doing outside of, say, the normal content approval, where they've created a Facebook page to support the product launch, and when we see employees taking action, we see corporations taking official action, we see records with a big R, records with a little R. How are you dealing with that with your clients, and where does that fall on the preservation spectrum for you?
So I am seeing it in both cases, where it's, you know, very clear that the corporation has possession, custody, and control, and when it's not so clear. And typically what I do using a tool like Exterro is, you know, you send interviews around to the individual custodians and find out where information is likely to be stored. And then from there, look at all the sources and try to determine, you know, if someone mentions, oh, there's, like you're saying, like a tentative site out in the, you know, out in cyberspace, and try to figure out if we have possession, custody, and control, and if we have to send a preservation notice or not. So, I mean, I kind of look at all the sources and make determinations, like, on a case-by-case basis, if that's what you're asking.
Mike, let me go to you for a moment. If any of you have attended any of my webcasts, you know that probably one of my favorite cases is In Re Pradaxa. This is a comedy of preservation errors, and anything that could go wrong in this case did. You want to talk to us a little bit about that?
Sure. You know, I think the In Re Pradaxa, under the old 37E or under the new 37E, wouldn't matter. Train wreck. I mean, absolute train wreck. You don't really like to judge your colleagues who were actually, you know, in the trenches fighting the war, but, it just, you read the opinion and it just screams at least inattentiveness, if not, you know, incompetence, if not willful disobedience of the court's order. Basically what you had is a class action against a drug manufacturer, and after a long, long series of meet and confers and trips before the judge to deal with motions, the defendants still couldn't get it right, and ultimately what they were found sanctionable for was not producing information from a key scientist. Note to self, if folks in your business refer to a colleague as the father of the drug, that person is a key player and should be preserved from, okay? The judge took particular exception to the fact that the defendants didn't quite see it that way and decided that this wasn't actually an important person and so didn't preserve their records. Another of their failings was they didn't disable an auto-delete function for the text emails or the text that their employees were sending. And there were documents that demonstrated that the leadership in the company instructed the scientists and the field sales force to communicate business information via text. So that was a big miss. Providing, when finally ordered to provide, shared drives to the plaintiffs, the defendant provided the shared drives to a vendor and said to the vendor, you know, go ahead and process information, but didn't give the vendor access to half of the information on the shared drive, which was encrypted. You can imagine the court wasn't too impressed with that. And finally, the court found that defendants wanting in terms of the scope of their litigation holds. This was clearly early on going to be class action at a nationwide level for this product. And what the defendants decided to do was to only issue litigation holds to people who were involved, field sales force, scientists, or whatnot, in the cases that were actually filed. So instead of issuing a blanket field sales force litigation hold, they said, well, we'll issue litigation holds to the field sales force in the Southern District of Illinois or the Northern District of New York, because that's where cases have been filed. And the court didn't think that was too good either. I'll tell you, I'll read you some language because, I don't know, Judge Waxse, if you've ever vented your spleen like Judge Herndon, the Chief Judge of the Southern District of Illinois, did, but this is good. When the court feels compelled, right, the court is frankly amazed that the defendants could raise such an argument and now argue before this court that they did not fully understand the broad scope of this litigation or the need to expand their litigation hold to all Pradaxa sales representatives. The defendants' efforts to suggest they and they alone decided to implement such a proportionality-tested litigation hold smacks of a post-debacle argument in desperation to salvage a failed strategy regarding production evasion. Ouch. That is not a good day for in-house or outside counsel when you are the target of that kind of language. So In Re Pradaxa is really, a great case to read if you want to learn what not to do in terms of preservation. I don't think it matters what standard was applied, new standard, old standard. These were folks that were going to get sanctioned, and they got sanctioned to the tune of just about $1 million. They got sanctioned to the extent that all foreign employees were required to come to the United States to sit for depositions. And after all of this, drawn out discovery, the court still, didn't forget what was really at the root here, which was to produce all relevant information from all relevant custodians, and so they still had to go back and do that. So really a very instructive case on how not to go about your preservation obligation.
One of the things I think that, and along with some of these other sanctioned cases, shows is, from my unscientific analysis of all these cases, they're generally and almost always two factors involved in these big sanctions. One is the screw-up on what you should have preserved or produced, but in almost every case, there's an element of cover-up. People are not transparent when they get caught in this mess, and they give the court or the other side either information that's not actually correct or actually lie to the other side. And start looking at these big sanction cases, and you'll find some element of that in all of them. And I think the easy answer is, if you screw up, admit it and try and correct it. Don't cover it up, because, you know, in Perdaxa, the judge started with like a $30,000 sanction the first time it got brought to his attention, but then it's back 90 days later and they're still screwing it up, so that's when he jumps up to almost a million. So I think there's a lot to be learned from reading this. Now, one little minor thing is the Seventh Circuit looked at this and reversed the part about the subpoenas, said you can't subpoena people in foreign countries, but the dollars stayed.
You know, one thing that I think this case is also instructive on, and Ronni, I'd be interested in your view of this, but, you know, this is clearly to me a failing both of in-house and outside counsel. You know, at Altria, we, and I've got some folks on my team here, but, you know, we are the ones that identify the key players. We are the ones that, in consultation with the case managers internally, will identify who the key custodians are and will develop the discovery plan around them. We obviously run that by outside counsel and make sure that they're comfortable with that, because after all, outside counsel has to walk it into a court. But, you know, to not identify the father of the drug as a key custodian is a colossal failure of in-house counsel. I think it probably, in that kind of an egregious case, is a failure of outside counsel too. But, you know, I'm sure you have a lot of interaction with your clients in terms of how key custodians are identified.
Yes, and I agree. And I think that the best cases are ones where that is a joint effort. I mean, really the in-house lawyer and the business people are the ones that know who was involved in the underlying transaction. As outside counsel, like, I can try to guess, but you really need both. You need both people to, you need the people who are involved in the transaction, and then you need someone like me to say, well, you need to go one step further. You haven't, you know, you haven't really covered, and you need to go to the periphery a little bit, you know, and try to help guide that discussion. But yeah. Yes, it's key for in-house lawyers to be involved in that.
You know, and I think one other piece of this is there's, I think, been too much focus solely on custodians. There are lots of situations where the ESI is not in the hands of any custodian. Some server is used to collect various data sets, and there's no person that can be deemed the custodian of that. So you've got to really figure out, and let's get so simplistic, but I'm afraid I see lawyers missing it. The starting point is, what are the disputed issues in the case? And it's amazing how, when I force counsel to list their factual issues and then list which ones are actually in dispute, the numbers drop, because lawyers have a tendency, they plead broadly and they answer more broadly. And so they'll deny things that really shouldn't be denied. And when you really focus on it, you can admit things without really hurting your case. It may be the reality that that's what happened. And then you don't do discovery on those. You only do discovery on what's in dispute. So you start limiting the issues and then figure out where the data is that may be relevant to those issues. And that's where you have to go beyond custodians and look at where else there may be data stored.
Ronni, let me ask you this. I know that text messages were an issue in NRA Pradaxa. Is there any other case law that talks about text messages and mobile devices and how they fit into this whole thing?
Yeah, there are a couple decisions on text messages, and by the way, text messages are what I hear most questions about right now from clients, how to handle text messages. That's the subject that causes corporations the most agita right now, in my opinion. And there is a case, Calderon versus Corporation, that's in the District of Puerto Rico, where a court ordered an adverse inference instruction for the failure to preserve text messages, and someone had the plaintiff in that case had actually saved some text messages but had let some text messages fall off and be purged. And so they ordered the court ordered an adverse inference instruction. And what I'll say about text messages, and particularly in the context of preservation, is that you have to figure out, like we were just saying about custodians on the custodian side, you have to figure out what your custodians had that is potentially relevant. If the custodians use text messaging to communicate about the facts underlying the case, then text messages have to be preserved. All of the, there's very few cases like Calderon, there's a couple others, and in each of the cases, the sole issue the court was focused on was relevance. You know, were the text messages likely to have relevant information? And so the way to figure that out is to ask all the custodians, did you use text messages to communicate about the substance of the case? You know, to find that out early, and if they say, you know, I don't use text, or I don't even have a cell phone, or, and if you could establish that none of them use texting to communicate about the facts, then perhaps you don't have to preserve the text in that case. Yes. So BYOD devices, first of all, like I was saying earlier, courts would not necessarily say that the corporation doesn't have possession, custody, and control of BYOD devices. A court might say that if they are giving their employees the ability to use their BYOD devices to communicate about work, that they might find, you'd have to know more facts about whether it's within possession, custody, control. Courts, there's a lot of case law that says that because employers can discipline their employees and because they control their compensation, those are indicia of possession, custody, and control. Because they can discipline the employee, they might have possession, custody, and control.
So even if it's not a BYOD device, the same thing applies.
Right, right. Like and you can think of it like this. Forgetting BYOD with devices, like your home computer. You know, courts would think, there's case law where courts have said that a home computer is within a possession, custody, and control of an employer. There's a case called it's involving Butterball, the chicken company, and the court in that case ordered the senior level executives to produce their webmail, their personal webmail, as an example. So it doesn't, you know, just because it's a BYOD device owned by the employee does not mean the court will not find its possession, custody, and control. So, I mean, there's plenty of ways to try to combat that in terms of having an acknowledgement where employees acknowledge that if there's case, you know, if a case comes up and you have to get access to it, that they don't have any expectation of privacy in the device. I mean, there's a lot of things you can do beyond the purpose of this talk right now, but yeah, you need to find out whether it's a BYOD device, whether it's a home computer, whether there is potentially relevant information.
Yeah, I think also it's an area, and it's, you know, this isn't a fail-safe, but you can, if you're a company, protect yourself to some degree through the policies that you implement. So, as Ronni mentioned, your entry point into the BYOD world is to sign an agreement that you're going to turn it over. You may have a policy in your company, as we do, that says every employee has an obligation to cooperate with all internal investigations, right? And the failure to do so could lead up to lots of different penalties, including termination. So, you've done yourself some good by establishing that policy. If you follow through on it and you say to somebody, look, I need to have your home computer, and they say no, and you say, all right, I can't physically invade your home, but I can fire you, you're fired, that's going to be something that counts in your favor when you finally stand in front of a court. You know, limiting what by policy can be used on certain devices. You can use this device, but you can't use it for any business purposes that contain confidential information or information subject to litigation. Again, not a fail-safe, but these are just kind of incremental things that when you finally do wind up before a judge, I think can help you make the case that you've done everything that you reasonably could. I mean, there still is this thing called the Stored Communications Act that, you know, prohibits you from, and the Fourth Amendment, which prohibits you from knocking down people's doors and taking stuff. But short of doing that, you can improve your position, I think.
Yeah, and just one more point is, you know, some clients ask me, well, what if we have this policy that says they can't use the BYOD for company business? Well, that, you know, like Mike was just saying, that's not a fail-safe, because what if they're in a deposition and they say during the deposition, if they're asked, well, yeah, did you use your BYOD to communicate about the facts underlying the case? And they say yes. Well, then it doesn't matter that you had this policy out there, because the employee themselves say that they have relevant information stored. So just because you have the you have to make sure that the practice follows the policy.
Exactly.
Mike, let me go over to you if we have no more questions on this. Let's go over to you and talk about 26, the changes to that, 26B1. Would
sure.
you summarize that for us?
Sure. So This is the proposed change that's going to impact the scope of discovery. And there's been a lot of debate about this on both sides of the V. And basically, since it's not up there, I mean, you have it. You know, what the big changes, I think, are the fact that proportionality, which has always been in Rule 26, but it was in a different section and not so front and center in terms of the scope of discovery calculus, but now it is. Now proportionality, and you can read it, you know, that unless otherwise limited by court order, parties may obtain discovery regarding any non-privileged matter that is relevant to any party's claim or defense. That's a key provision. It's in the old rule, it's in the new rule, but I think folks too quickly lose sight of the fact that you must establish as a threshold that it's relevant to a claim or defense, and proportional to the needs of the case, considering, and then a long list of things that a court will consider. So proportionality, a key thing. I think, and that's really what's, I think, gained most of the focus in all the commentary back and forth. However, another big change is language that is proposed to be omitted from the new rule, and it used to read, there's two provisions I think are important. The first is, for good cause, the court may order discovery of any matter relevant to the subject matter involved in the action. That's in the current rule. The proposed 26B1 would drop that. I'm not sure it's all that important that it's omitted, because I'm willing to bet that if a litigant comes before Judge Waxse and demonstrates good cause that there's a need for information relevant to the subject matter, that they're probably going to get the relief they seek. But it's having been removed, there are some folks that believe that that's really going to be a huge limitation on their ability to get broad discovery. The other important omission in the proposed rule is, relevant information need not be admissible at the trial if the discovery appears reasonably calculated to lead to the discovery of admissible evidence. The reasonably calculated exception that swallows the discovery rule currently. Really, that is the language that I think has brought on this great crisis in terms of overpreservation and ultimately the massive amounts of information that gets exchanged in litigation, because it's been pretty easy historically for litigants to come before a court and say, you know, there is a reasonable basis for me to believe, it is reasonably calculated that the information I'm seeking is going to be relevant, even if not admissible. So I think omitting that language is also going to be particularly helpful in reining in the scope of the discovery. You know, getting back to the actual language of the proposed rules, you know, having participated in the advisory committee process with a group that is primarily defense-oriented called Lawyers for Civil Justice, you know, we had kind of a front-row seat to see what the plaintiff's concerns were about the proposed changes to Rule 26B1, and it really tended to focus at the end of the day on their belief that they would be preempted in their discovery efforts because the defendants would be able to demonstrate that it was just too expensive for them to comply with the discovery at issue. And this was particularly of concern to folks who represent plaintiffs on, say, civil rights issues, where there may not be a lot of dollars at issue, or maybe employment matters, but there are really important issues that should, you know, have their day in court. And so plaintiffs were concerned that this would all kind of collapse into a simple proportionality test of, you know, what's the burden and expense of complying with discovery versus what's at stake in the litigation in terms of the quantum. And the courts were invariably going to see that, you know, $1.5 million to produce discovery in a $100,000 case didn't make much sense, and they wouldn't let those cases proceed through, you know, rigorous discovery. I think the way the drafters have drafted the language, they did it purposefully to kind of de-emphasize the focus on the expense issue, because they start out by saying, and proportional to the needs of the case considering the importance of the issues at stake. I think that was very purposefully the first in the list, because there are certainly low dollar value, very important issues, especially in the civil rights area, the labor area, that certainly do deserve fulsome discovery to flesh those issues out. the amount in controversy, the party's relative access to information. I found this to be a particularly interesting aspect of the discussion back and forth in shaping this rule, because on the defense side, where I've always been, and particularly in defending class actions, as I had prior to coming in-house in the securities context, you know, you're in the classic asymmetric litigation context, where one investor who has really no information that is subject to discovery other than evidence that they purchased 100 shares of the stock can leverage huge costs in discovery against the securities issuer or the corporation in a products liability case. And by doing so, by imposing millions of dollars of costs in discovery, leverage the settlement that they're looking for. Interestingly, the plaintiffs have, taken, I heard it a lot in the public testimony before the advisory committee, they talked about asymmetric litigation in a completely different context. They talked about the fact that big corporations are the sole custodians of all the information necessary to prove their case. And if you think about it, they're largely right. And so they cast themselves as the underdog in the asymmetry, right? That they didn't have access, and so any rules that constrain the scope of discovery as were being proposed would necessarily advantage the holder of all the information. Lots of interesting debate back and forth about that. I thought it was, you know, whether it was clever or a deeply held genuine belief on the plaintiff's side, it didn't really matter to me. It just showed that people were very passionate about fiddling with the scope of discovery and very concerned that their clients ultimately were going to be either on the defense side, continued to be prejudiced by overwhelming discovery costs, or on the plaintiff side, be shut out of courtrooms, and they would, you know, say this is just another example, like the Iqbal Twombly pleading standards that now make it more difficult for me to get my case in, and the class action limitations that came out of the Walmart case. They linked these to other decisions and other contexts that they would claim shut the doors of the courthouse to plaintiffs. And so very, very spirited debate in terms of this scope of discovery. I think it's a good compromise where they've landed.
You know, I think if you go back and look for cases where judges have actually decided this proportionality question, you're going to be shocked at how few there are. And I think it's pretty simple why there are so few. You know, I've been on the bench 15 years now, and the few times I've had it brought to me, it's been impossible to resolve. And the reason is, if you could figure out the importance of the issues and the amount in controversy, you could probably settle the case. I mean, the problem is, the plaintiff says there's $10 million in controversy, and the defendant says, this is a $0 case. Now, how do you figure out the proportionality between the 10 million and the zero? And then you start talking about importance of the issues, and that it's all your perspective. I mean, there may be something very important to this individual plaintiff that the corporation says, who could care less about that issue? So it's not an easy concept. And then, not only is it a difficult concept to deal with, all they have done here is moved the words. I mean, this rule isn't really changed. They moved it from 26B to C to 26B1. And the idea was, well, if we move it up, it'll have more importance. You know, in my many years of practice and being on the bench, the location of the word has never been an important factor in its. I mean, it's the same word wherever you put it. And this idea, I mean, obviously there was a lot of back and forth, and so one of the trade-offs was we'll put importance of the issue in front of amount in controversy. I mean, how that's supposed to have some significance in terms of a ruling, I mean, I know it got involved in the debate, but I don't see it coming out in rulings that the judge says, well, importance was listed first, so I'm going to give that a lot more weight.
Yeah, but I think context matters, right? I think it's not just that the words have been reordered and moved. It's how that change came about. It came about because you apparently got the entire legal profession, academics, practitioners, the courts, to recognize and agree that there were maybe not unanimity in terms of this agreement, but they by and large agreed that discovery has run amok and the costs are unreasonable and that parties are on the defense side being forced to settle cases just because of the overwhelming cost. So all of that is the backdrop for this reshuffling of the words. And I don't think that's going to be lost on, one, parties who are going to now invoke it more frequently, or two, courts who are going to be listening to the arguments. So I don't dispute, Judge, for a minute that you haven't seen many of these in the past. I just wonder if you're not going to see more in the future.
Yeah, I mean, we may see more, but I think you're giving a lot more credit to lawyers and judges than they deserve.
Lawyers are awesome.
You know, there are a lot of awesome lawyers out there, but, you know, let me give you one example that I use too frequently. But a little while back, I'm doing these case management conferences where we discuss ESI, and I asked the counsel, I said, is there a lot of ESI in this case? And they said, quite a bit. And I said, well, how are you going to handle it? Oh, Judge, we're just going to print it out. And I said, print it out? What, I mean, first, there's the environmental issue. But secondly, you print all this out, and you've lost your ability to search it. And the one lawyer said, oh, no, Judge, we thought about that. Once we get the printouts, we're going to scan them in so we can search them.
Mike, only a lawyer would say that, right? Yes. Mike, let me ask this. If you're going to ask for or make a motion for a cost shifting, proportionality, whatever you want to call it, it makes sense to have your ducks in a row. That's not always the case, though, is it?
No, and there's a case, a 2012 case, I believe, out of Southern District of New York, called Pippins v. KPMG, and what it's a Fair Labor Standards Act case brought by a bunch of KPMG associates who said essentially, you know, we've worked like an unbelievable amount of overtime, and you've never compensated us for it, and so we as a class are going to bring this this suit. And KPMG, and this is a preservation issue, which is interesting. What they said is, look, there's 2,500 hard drives of former KPMG associates that you, the plaintiffs, are saying, you know, likely contain relevant information in terms of, you know, you'll find metadata of when folks were working on documents and when they weren't and when they were logged in and when they weren't, and that's all, you know, going to go to the core of our uncompensated overtime claim, and so you need to preserve that. And KPMG said, look, it's going to cost us, you know, $1.5 million to preserve these 2,500 hard drives. And they said, so we're not going to do it. So the plaintiffs, quite reasonably, I think, said, well, look, maybe you're right. Maybe we don't need to preserve all of them. Let's sample. Let us look at five. You know, you pick five randomly sampled out of those 2,500. We'll take a look at what's on them, and we'll see whether or not there's anything there, and maybe this issue goes away. Heck no, says KPMG. We're not going to let you look at that information. Said, well, how about a 30B6 deposition of a corporate representative who can at least talk to the practices and what might be found? Heck no, we're not going to do that, said KPMG. We're sticking by our position that preserving 2,500 hard drives is just unreasonable, it's burdensome, and therefore we shouldn't have to do it. Well, Pippins walks into the court and says to the judge, I need some help. And the judge said, you're going to get the help because I'm going to make KPMG preserve those 2,500 hard drives because KPMG has been just unreasonable in their approach to resolving this issue. The court basically says, you know, I have to read some language because I just love it when judges like Judge Waxse get all energized about something. but this court said it smacks of chutzpah, no definition required, to argue that the magistrate failed to balance the costs and benefits of preservation when KPMG refused to cooperate with that analysis by providing the very item that would, if examined, demonstrate whether there was any benefit at all to preservation. And the court was 100% right, and the plaintiffs were 100% right. Imagine, forget hard drives. Imagine if there was just 2,500 documents that were at issue, that were subject to preservation. And KPMG said, it's just too hard for me to keep these 2,500 documents in a banker's box. I'm not going to do it. And the plaintiff said, well, let me see a couple of them just to see whether or not that's reasonable. You know, there's no way in the world that they would have gotten away with not preserving those 2,500 pages just on their word that it was too burdensome. They didn't even contend that it wasn't relevant. They just said it's a burden argument. And so, you know, this was a self-inflicted wound. Again, I don't know where the fault lies, if it's in-house or if it's outside or a combination, but I bet you in retrospect they and I don't know how this was ultimately resolved, and so maybe they did go back and say, you know what, after all, maybe 5 hard drives is a pretty good idea. If I was a plaintiff, I would have said, no thanks, you just keep those until I need them. But, you know, it's just another case where you can't make a burden argument, you can't make a proportionality argument unless there's some facts for the court to consider. Simply saying $2,500, $1.5 million too much isn't going to get you there. I think the thing that to me was very helpful out of this opinion, and it was kind of a sidebar, but this court recognized that proportionality applies to preservation. Even though the language, you know, and there was much debate in this federal rules amendment process about including proportionality language in Rule 37E. It never got there. It is in 36B governing the scope of discovery, but the court here acknowledged this was 2012, so before this whole rule change came about, that necessarily proportionality plays a role in determining the scope of preservation.
Yeah, and the other thing that's explicit in that opinion is that cooperation is essential. And I think one of the reasons the judge went so clearly to one side is it was clear who wasn't cooperating.
Yeah.
And I was just going to say there's one problem with this opinion, and I completely agree with your analysis. And I think even they wouldn't even let one hard drive, like I think not even 5, not even one. And I think the court mentioned that in the opinion. But one thing the court said that really bothers me is she said that you can't decide that proportionality, kind of what Judge Waxse was saying, is too difficult for you to decide on your own. So you need to keep preserving until you can get to court and argue it. And that's really problematic for defense lawyers and corporations that you can't make, that she's saying that these proportionality determinations are too complicated for you to make on your own. So that's concerning to me that she said that. And not many courts have picked up on that particular part of the opinion, but that's very disconcerting to me.
But you know, but I think we do. I mean, I think we make decisions every day in every litigation about where to draw lines, right? And so we do it. I think this case was, because it was focused on such a discrete, you know, body of information, that it was, you know, the court maybe was being a little more precise with their language than was necessary, right?
Yes.
Because I think there's no way getting around the fact that you start off all litigation by making decisions. Are you a key custodian? Are you not? Is this a repository that has information or doesn't it? Those are always subject to second guessing, but I think as long as you can demonstrate you've made those determinations in good faith, you're going to be okay when you get before a judge. You may have to change your approach, but you're not going to be sanctioned for intentional misconduct. This is the posture of this one was so strange, though, because KPMG was the movement here. They sought the protective order knowing they're going to go into that argument with the facts that they had, which was, we didn't let them look at anything, we're not going to let them look at anything, we're not going to produce a deponent to talk about anything, judge, give us some relief. I mean, I don't get it. I mean, wow.
You know, this question contained a very important point that you need to keep in mind. the easiest way to avoid sanctions of any kind is get an agreement with the other side on what you're going to do, whether it's preservation or production or whatever. If you've got an agreement on what you're doing, the court's not going to get involved in sanctioning somebody. You may have screwed up and agreed to it, but you're not going to get sanctioned for it.
Right.
Your Honor, in the 7 or 8 minutes we have left, I want to leave some time for you all to give some closing thoughts on, assuming that all of these changes pass as written, what do we do? How do we go from here? So I'd like to start with you and just get some thoughts about what are some takeaways?
Well, I think some of them I'm repeating myself. If you screw up, don't cover up. I mean, that is so important. And you look at all these sanction cases. And, you know, sometimes it just amazes me the kind of situations counsel get in. And, I mean, one of the cases we had on our list was Actos. And as I'm sure you remember, Actos was a $1.5 million verdict for the plaintiff with $9 billion in punitives added on top of it, primarily for discovery problems, because the judge let the jury make the determination of whether there was problems in the production by the defendants, and they certainly did. And when you start looking at these cases, the first thing that comes out, in addition to don't cover up, is avoid the problem by cooperating in the first place. And you know, one of the things that came out of Duke when I was on the panel that was pushing cooperation, and I was giving my presentation about it, and one of the general counsel from a major U.S. pharmaceutical company said, "Well, Judge, you just don't understand. We hire aggressive lawyers for this kind of litigation, and they don't cooperate." And I said, "Well, I think maybe you don't understand, because when I practiced law, if my general counsel said, do it this way, I did it that way. Clients need to take responsibility for their attorneys and tell them, we know you're aggressive, but we're going to save time and we're going to get better results if you start cooperating instead of battling about all these things." And I get accused of being cynical sometimes, but you know, I practiced law for 30 years in a big firm and a small firm, and I know the problem of hourly billing. I mean, you may have a cooperating partner who thinks that's how you ought to do things, but the people below that, their only goal is to get their hours in, and you get your hours in by having battles, not by solving battles. And so that's another issue that someday we're going to have to deal with. And I think the trend is away from that, because people realize it's the wrong incentive to just speed and inexpensive to pay people more if they make the battle go on longer.
Ronni, your takeaways.
So my takeaways are, whether the new rules are adopted or not, are the same, is that you have to have, and we've talked about it here today, steps in place, systems in place for identifying custodians, for identifying non-custodial sources, for sending out litigation holds, for reminding custodians. I mean, you just have to establish reasonableness. I mean, that's the key takeaway. And having systems in place to do all that, and it's repeatable, it's consistent, will avoid sanctions and will avoid you falling within 37E prejudice or intent to deprive another. So that's my takeaway.
Okay, Mike.
I think on the scope side of things with Rule 26B1, I think we're likely to see in the early goings, if it's adopted, some more litigation about litigation, right? I think there will be some fights about whether or not a proportionality determination was made at the wrong time or with an insufficient amount of facts. And I think we're going to have to see several of those play out and get opinions from magistrates and district court judges and maybe even at the appellate level to see where the lines are drawn and where they seem to be holding up. And I think, you know, depending on where that goes, and I really have no idea where it's going to go, one side or the other is going to kind of recede back to business as usual, and the proportionality issue will become much less of an issue. If plaintiffs see that they can't get everything in the world just for asking, they will stop asking for everything in the world. If, on the other hand, courts are solicitous of the arguments that plaintiffs are making, I think defendants will continue to overpreserve and overproduce in discovery because that is essentially what the courts are directing them to do. So incremental, slow change. I'm for the changes. I think they can do some good, but it's going to take some time.
You know, let me add one quick thing.
Sure.
You need to look, if you have the time, at how many big sanction cases are out there. They're minimal. They get a lot of attention, but as Judge Shenlon said in one of her last sanction opinions, she and her long time on the bench, I think, has sanctioned four times. And you look across the country, there are minimal sanction cases. And yet, they get a lot of attention, and they scare the hell out of people. So we got all this discussion about rule changes when I think if you put it in perspective and sort of did a cost-benefit analysis, the odds of getting a huge sanction against you are pretty low, and yet the fear of it is driving a lot of behavior that we don't need.
Thank you. And just as a closing note here, all the cases we cited during this are in your take-home materials, so they're all in the thumb drives that you were given. So I hope that you all enjoy reading them as much as we did. As you can see that a lot of cases have a lot of color to them, and it's a lot of fun to read. Oh, on Wednesday. Okay. All right, well, when you do get your take-home materials, you will have as much fun reading them as we did. So, Your Honor, Ronni, Mike, on behalf of Exterro and a very grateful audience, thank you very much for our keynote.